Hi everyone, I'm Marie Driscoll. I work with CoreSite and I also am a professor here at FIT. We're here as part of this program is the 15th Annual Sustainability Conference at FIT. And we're here to talk about changemakers in circularity. Just a little bit about me. I work with CoreSite Research. We sit at the intersection of retail and technology. Sustainability is my passion. I've been watching sustainability since I was an analyst on Wall Street and looked at ESG issues. But I have a panel here with me who are much more informed than I am, and I'm going to ask them to introduce themselves. Danielle, would you like to start?
Sure. My name is Danielle Nkojo, and I'm the manager of global sustainable product for Contour Brands, parent company of Lee and Wrangler Jeans.
Thanks, Danielle. And Adam?
Very good to be here. And Marie, thank you for hosting us. So my name is Adam Siegel. I've been working in retail and consumer products for now over a decade, specifically focused on sustainability and ethical production. First working with some of the largest brands, and then more recently, I started a new venture focused on branded resale to help brands take control of their resale experience.
Thanks, Adam. And Logan?
Yep. Hi, everyone. I'm Logan Duran, and I lead environmental, social governance, and sustainability for Tapestry. So we own Kate Spade, Coach, Stuart Weitzman. I've been in the space for many years now, and really excited to be here and happy to support FIT. My wife actually went to FIT, so always looking for opportunities to engage with FIT.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much, all three of you, for being here. And thank you, FIT, for hosting us. So the topic is changemakers in circularity. Circularity is a big topic in sustainability. And I think if we go back about 10 or 15 years, we can look at the Ellen MacArthur Foundation and how the foundation approached circularity in terms of a circular economy. And I have to read notes here, so excuse me, but a circular economy builds on and rebuilds the overall system health. It recognizes the importance of the economy needing to work efficiently across all scales, big and small, for organizations, individuals, globally and locally. It's based on three principles: design out waste and pollution, keep products and materials in use, and regenerate natural systems. And the key building blocks to success really are product design, new business models, and reverse logistics. So with that as a backdrop, and I know that each of you can fill in the dots between those items, really, what principles of circularity are at work at Contour, Danielle?
Sure. I mean, we're a part of the coalition that is the Ellen MacArthur Foundation's Make Fashion Circular, particularly their jeans redesign initiative. And we've adopted those broader concepts, but certainly when it comes to textiles or the fashion industry, a more kind of specific rubric would be to make things that can be made again, things that can be made, used more, and made from safe, recycled, or renewable inputs. And so we're approaching circularity from those three perspectives.
Mm-hmm. And how about at Tapestry, Logan?
Yeah, we definitely take a very similar approach. I mean, I think we're still very early on in our journey towards sort of more circular product, but you know, we really stand behind and really lean into the sort of the durability and the quality aspect of the products that we make. We've had a repair center specifically for Coach brand for many, 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 many years now. And, you know, I looked up the numbers, and I think, you know, 2018, we repaired 43,000 products. And 2019, I think it was like 45 or 46. thousand products. And that ends up being, you know, of all of the stuff that comes back, we obviously, there are some that are just so beyond repair that they end up sort of going on the shelf, and we end up trying to find other ways to satisfy the customer. But for the most part, 85% of what's coming back to us, we're able to repair and put right back out there. And so I think really making sure that our products are able to be repaired, that they're using durable materials, and really sort of promoting that leather care and longevity is really where we lean in on circularity at this point in time, and really trying to figure out what the next opportunities are for us.
Yeah, that's interesting about the amount of repair work that you're doing, because it's part of a brand promise. I mean, one of the things that's interesting is that Tapestry with Coach and Contour with Lees and Wranglers, both of these brands are like approaching, I think is Tapestry, is Coach 80 years old and Lee and Wranglers about 100. I mean, that just shows to the longevity of building products that last.
Yeah, we're Tapestry's 80 this year. And it is always, I mean, I will say, having been out and worked out sort of in the facility that houses the repair center, every once in a while, there's always a lot of buzz when like a really old product comes into the repair center. Everyone gets really, really excited. And even the craftspeople who are working on it just really get excited. And I think it sort of speaks to sort of the history and heritage of the brand, but I think also just sort of this excitement that people have around just sort of well-made quality products. And I think that's ultimately what we talk a lot about at Tapestry, just from a circularity and sort of reducing environmental impact perspective. But I think that's something that, people just really gravitate towards and really, really appreciate.
And certainly, like I've seen jeans that are on display as artifacts, right? Because they've made it for so long, right, Danielle?
Yeah, and I think like one of the points that Logan was making, and it's key to this, the circularity or to the circular economy, is both emotional and physical durability, right? Like these are treasured items. I can't tell you how many times I've had someone approach me and tell me a story about how long they've had a pair of Wrangler jeans, right? They are, cowboy culture. They are work wear. They are like part of what people think of and when they think of American heritage. And they're very proud of how long they've kept them. And there are a number of people who are vintage dealers, right? And people who keep this stuff and put it on display. And so, that's the way we've been doing circularity, right? Before it even became known as a term or a concept.
Right. So Adam, given the view that you've had across many different retailers and brands, I mean, where do you think the US sits in terms of developing circularity?
That's a good question. Well, first off, I'll say these initiatives that we just heard about are super cool, and we certainly need more of this in the industry. It's a little hard for me to say where the U.S. sits relative mm-hmm. to other geographies, but I do get the sense that Europe is farther ahead, both in terms of the regulatory climate as well as just the brand culture or ethos. Ellen MacArthur Foundation that you referenced, they're based in Europe,
right?
As are a whole lot of initiatives from the UN multilateral programs down to, the individual brands that tend to be leaders in this space. So I do see Europe as being ahead, not necessarily that I have metrics to show it, but mm-hmm. I think there's a lot that we can learn from European brands.
When I started looking at ESG as an analyst in 2003, you did look to Europe because they were more advanced. It's part of the way they think. But both of these brands being around for 80 plus years, or these three brands, speaks to like some organizations that really care about their brand, build the brand so that it has longevity, not necessarily so that it's circular, but so that it has longevity. And that that helps reduce landfill and waste and a lot of the environmental sustainability issues, right?
hey, building products that are meant to last and that do last is the single best way to keep products out of landfill. You know, if products retain their value over time, then even if the first customer decides they don't want that anymore, there's still enough value in it to sell it to a second customer or a third customer or rent it after that. So the best way to keep products out of landfill is to make them last.
To make them well, right. You know, just FYI, I've brought my classes to the Coach Archives, and it has created brand advocates by having them look at these designs that have been brought back to life by subsequent designers like 30, 50 years later. And during the summer, I teach at FIT, not last year because of COVID, but we had international students from all over the world that really learned something else about Coach because of the archives. So just a FYI.
It's a pretty exciting space, and I think it's a throwback to the heritage, and I think that's definitely something that we have tried to focus on and really sort of lean into. But at the same time, I don't want sort of people to think that it's all just about repair and durability. I mean, I think there's also the conversation, and I think Danielle spoke about it at the beginning as well, which was just, you know, making sure that you're making product from the get-go with safe and renewable materials. And so that's really been something that we've been trying to work on, as well as just making sure that we are starting to, and you're seeing this across all of our brands, but starting to introduce more environmentally preferred materials on the front end, as well as trying to make sure that we're making durable products for longevity.
So is that one of the bigger opportunities at Tapestry across the brands?
I think so. I mean, I think you've definitely seen each of the different brands sort of take their own approach to it. The most recent runway shows with Coach have really all started to lean into and increase adoption of environmentally preferred materials, whether it's looking at things like tanning processes and, you know, really prioritizing gold and silver rated leather working group tanneries and really reducing impact there, or adoption of recycled polyester. And so, you know, Kate Spade has been doing, has had recycled polyester in the majority of their liners of their products for the last couple of years now. And I think, you know, recently, I think Unify, the sort of the yarn provider for those recycled inputs, shared that, you know, we had diverted around 15 million plastic bottles from landfill throughout the life of the program over the last couple of years. So, you know, admittedly, you're diverting from landfill, and it's not a perfect solution, but it's definitely a better solution than continued reliance on the fossil fuel industry.
Right. It seems like most of the solutions in sustainability are just better than what's existing. They're not perfect. And so we iterate towards towards improvement, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's definitely the approach that we're trying to take, is sort of this progress over perfection, right. You know, not being stifled by having to be perfect, but really just getting started. And that's what we've seen, you know, both at Coach and Kate Spade and Stuart Weitzman, is just how do you start to introduce these preferred materials in a way that, you know, design is able to start commercializing them and using them in the products. And then, you know, throughout that life of the product, having the support. And so it's things like, you know, at point of sale with the customers, helping them understand how to care for their product, whether it's sort of leather care, or even saying, hey, come back in the first year and we'll help you sort of give it a refresh, just to make sure that you understand that, you know, this is, you don't often think about it, but you sort of have to take care of your leather products the same way you would take care of a car. You know, it needs a little bit of TLC to really get the best out of it, just like all of the things we have. And so just being willing and able to really engage with the customers, and it creates a good, you know, opportunity to continue to build strong relationships with customers.
It's like, I think it helps with telling a brand story, showing how to care for product, because as you put your hand on product, you're becoming more involved in it. You know, it's not just an adornment. It's becoming, you're having more of a relationship with it.
And that really speaks to keeping products in use longer, right? Like, we are starting to, as part of the commitment to the Ellen MacArthur Foundation Jeans Redesign Project, we're actually putting clearer information in our products about the care and maintenance of your jeans, right? Like, people are washing their jeans too often, right? And sometimes it's hard to hear, but the truth is these were designed as workwear. They were designed to be durable. And so maybe you can wash your jeans less. Maybe you can wash them at a lower temperature. You know, some of that will not only preserve the product, but actually decrease the impact that microfibers can have on your local waterways and oceans. And so learning how to preserve not just the products you own, but how it affects the environment around you, we want to be able to communicate that to our customers as well.
Yeah. I remember being in Amsterdam and seeing jeans that were never washed. And the companies recollect them because they help them design the next set of jeans, because these are where the creases should be. It's funny. But so Adam, like, what do you think is the greatest opportunity in apparel, fashion, footwear, accessories for circularity?
First, I'll say that I think we're living in a pretty cool time right now, because circular business models in the fashion industry are becoming really popular. Mm-hmm. In particular, the two that I've thought a lot about are rental and resale. Of course, we heard about a third, which is repair. Mm-hmm. You know, all of those are certainly interesting, but of course, my focus is on resale, and that's because the trend line is growing like that. It's just a market that's been booming, and there's really no sign of slowdown. So, you know, in the past decade, it's mainly been a result of the third party sites like Poshmark, ThredUp, RealReal, Depop, right. StockX, et cetera. You know, they've made it cool mm-hmm. to buy used products.
Right.
And of course, buying used is the most sustainable product you can buy, and it also fulfills an element of circularity.
Right.
But that said, you know, if a Coach product is being sold on the RealReal, Coach doesn't know who that customer is, much less do they benefit from the sale of that product the second time or the third time or the fourth time around. So, you know, it's fantastic that you make products that are meant to last, but you're not benefiting after that first sale. So I think the biggest opportunity is for brands to take control of the resale market and the experience for their customers and their products.
Well, and you are seeing a lot of luxury brands start to, like, didn't Kering recently invest in Vestiaire?
Yeah.
I mean, you're starting to see the fact that people are looking at, well, this is our product and we're losing that customer. And how can we continue to re-engage that customer? And also they're missing new customers that are coming to the brand because it's at resale and it's at a lower price.
We're working with one brand that just launched a month ago, a really cool French Canadian women'swear brand. Mm-hmm. And, soon after they launched, they got a number of emails from customers saying, hey, we loved your stuff, but I had committed to only buying used. That's important to me. So I'm excited now that I have the opportunity to buy from you again. I think there's this growing cohort of consumers that truly does care about sustainability. And in particular, a lot of them have vowed to themselves that they'll only buy used products. It's easy to do now. It's not hard to find used products. And so, you know, it's not a significant commitment. But of course, that means that if brands are not participating in the resale market, they're just losing out on that customer.
So Logan, at Tapestry, how are these kind of ideas how are they being accepted throughout the organization? What do the vet, you know, what does the C-suite think about this? What do the product, the brand managers think about this, the brand presidents?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, environmental, social governance, sustainability, I think is definitely really ramped up at Tapestry over the last, you know, we've obviously been doing, we've been reporting externally for, you know, 8 or 9 years now, right, on our efforts. And I think it's only just accelerated. And I think COVID ultimately only just accelerated the efforts. We're not currently engaged in any sort of direct resale, mm-hmm. but definitely always looking at it and trying to investigate what that looks like for Tapestry and its brands. I think, you know, there is a lot of excitement and there is a lot of really encouragement. And I think you've seen it with the increased use of preferred materials from Kate Spade and even sort of the most recent shows, as I mentioned, that at Coach, that there is this sort of shift in sort of how we make product. And just, you know, when we're starting to think and lean into the conversation around repair and longevity and durability, I think that ultimately then, if the sort of design teams are starting to think more about, you know, how long is a product expected to last, it may start to influence how we design, right? And how we create products. And are you, you know, we're not necessarily, you know, finalized on this, but, you know, really starting to look at different design principles and just making sure that we're thinking about sort of longevity of product when we're designing things and thinking about what is that, you know, when you look at the made to be made again principle of the Ellen MacArthur right. Foundation, what does that look like if you get a product back that you're not able to repair? How do you demanufacture? How do you deconstruct? What are those component parts? And are they able to be recycled? That's not somewhere where we've figured that out just yet, but it's definitely sort of exciting opportunities and exciting space in how we create, design, and care for product at end of life.
Yeah, it's. I think it's so interesting to have, like, coaches, it's partly fashion, partly what drives the product. It may be great product, but it's fashion. And fashion goes in and out of style, not to say that, and you have some bags that sell more on fashion and others that sell more on function and durability, right? But you want to design both with the intention that they would have the same kind of life cycle, the same duration, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think you're ultimately trying to just promote how do you measurably reduce the environmental impact of a product across its life. And, you know, at the end of the day, you know, we've definitely seen, as Adam was sharing, you know, an increased focus, an increased consumer set focused on reduced environmental impact, on sustainability, on buying used, et cetera. And even the folks who are maybe still buying new, they ultimately want to see products with a reduced environmental impact. But at the same time, they're likely coming into the store looking for, you know, fit, color, quality, right. aesthetic. And then the sort of the underlying expectation is that it's also a reduced environmental impact from a baseline.
Danielle, can you tell us what the experience is at Wrangler and Leva and I'm sorry, and Lee's?
Yeah, so we're really, right now, we're really focused on the inputs. One of the things that we're doing is looking at the sustainable attributes of the materials that we're using to construct our products. Anything from either organic and organic cotton, sustainable cotton, because, you know, only about 1% of the cotton that's grown in the globally is actually organic. So people talk a lot about organic, but that's not the only sustainable cotton material. We're also looking at what we call alternative fibers, hemp, linen, flax, including those in our products. We're also being thoughtful about what's used on our products, right? So you have the cotton fabric, but we're avoiding any kind of, it's called potassium permanganate spray, right? PP spray is what they call it. But that's what they used to use to distress the jeans. And And they used to use pumice stones, right? That mm-hmm. are harmful when those actually end up being washed out of our machines. And so there's more of laser finishing now happening yeah. that's less harmful to the environment. So certainly constructing products that are made sustainably, made from sustainable sources. And then we're certainly looking at the end of life. We're looking at both mechanical and chemical recycling through partnerships. Certainly cotton is highly recyclable because it's one of those fibers that'll stay kind of longer, because you need longer fibers when you're going to recycle something back into yarn, back into fabric. So when we have 100% cotton jeans, those can actually go through a mechanical recycling process fairly easily. I say fairly easily, right? Because it's not an easy process, but it can get through the process. Our challenge is for blended materials. So the Ellen MacArthur Foundation sets a limit at 98% cellulosic fibers, meaning natural fibers like cotton in their jeans, because any more than that 2% of stretch makes it harder to pull those fibers apart. So we're looking at more natural stretch, right? So those can be part of a natural, either mechanical or chemical recycling process that produces new fibers that we can use to make new product. Where we are still kind of ideating and thinking of what it would look like for contour brands is around those kind of resale, the take back, resale, mm-hmm. e-commerce, rental hasn't come up as much for us, but certainly ideating and thinking what that would look like for us. We've seen it work and work well for luxury brands, but we're a product that's really accessible to the American public, to the global public. And so you've got a product that in its original state is available at under $20. You know, what does that look like on the secondary market? What's right. interesting though, is when we talk about vintage Wrangler, right? Mm-hmm. Vintage Wrangler and Lee, those will sell for, you know, two times, three times what the original market price was for them. So we're actually in conversation about figuring out what that could look like for us now. And would we do resale ourselves? Would we do that with a partner? We're really figuring that out. And it's great that we have resources to look for to other companies that are thinking about it, but also resources like the technology that Adam's company is creating.
Yeah, I was just thinking, Adam, like, you're a great platform for vintage, for that one of a kind piece, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And actually some of the brands that we will be launching with in the next couple of months are, you know, 100, 150 year old companies that that have that heritage and vintage quality. one thing that I think is worthwhile just mentioning, in terms of a framework for thinking about circularity with fashion brands in particular, you know, similar to the mantra of reduce, reuse, recycle, you know, there is a hierarchy for how to handle products in the most sustainable of ways. I think about the longevity of products and the circularity of products with regard to the quality or condition of products. So in other words, a product that's in perfect condition doesn't need to come back to a central facility to be, you know, cleaned, inspected, inventoried, mm-hmm. et cetera, before it's then resold. Those products can often be sold peer-to-peer directly from the seller to the new buyer. It's only products that are in poorer condition, that do require some sort of refurbishment or repair, where it does make sense to bring it to a central facility before then reselling it. And then of course, items that are in the poorest of condition can go through recycling channels if those recycling channels are available. So in my mind, we need to think a bit more strategically about how we take back if we take back product, mm-hmm. Or if we can enable resale without necessarily taking back the product. And the other element, you know, in addition to the environmental impacts of that hierarchy, is the financial impacts of that hierarchy. Because sending products to a central facility is just an expensive process, and that eats away at the financial value or the resale value of that product. So what I like is that there's now more options than ever for brands to engage in resale, repair, and recycling so that they can find the highest value use for any particular product.
It does. It, each time the product is touched, it costs somebody money, right? But that's where, like what Logan was saying about repair, it's like if you're repairing, much of Coach's products is sold at full price. And if it's sold at full price and then it's repaired, the repair piece, I think that creates a bond with the consumer. And the consumer trusts the brand and is more willing to pay full price because they know that, in fact, they have, it may need repair, it may not. And I think one of the things that The RealReal has shown us is they're authenticating product. And then they show you how the kind of value that your product can keep, right?
Well, for what it's worth, what I've seen with the brands that we're working with at Recurate is that 80 to 85% of products are in near perfect condition.
Really?
In a lot of cases, it's new with tags. And if it's not new with tags, it's very often like new. And that's because, you know, things are not, in reality, items are not worn that often. Or in a lot of cases, items were purchased and then they end up in the back of someone's closet and never worn or certainly not frequently. And so there's a lot of product.
There's a lot of inventory out
there. And of course, for product that's in need of repair, it makes sense to repair it. That's for certain. But there's a lot of really, you know, near new product out there that doesn't require handling, doesn't require significant repairs. And so if we can find ways to bring that out of people's closets or out from under their beds and back into circulation, that's one of the best opportunities for circularity.
So Logan, as you listen to that and you think about that, like if Coach were to do resale on its platform, are your peers or are the people that you work with asking, is this going to cannibalize our new product line? What's the impact that it could have on your business? And how is this, like, how does resale change your business model? I mean, the Ellen MacArthur Foundation says you have to have new business models to incorporate circularity into an economy. So it has, I'm just wondering how you think through that, knowing that you're not doing it yet, but some of the questions that you ask.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's so you're absolutely right. We are not doing resale. And I always have to be careful. We're not, I mean, it's definitely something that we're always looking at just because it's just the trend that we see in the market. And so we're always just wanting to sort of stay aware of what's going on. I mean, I will share that, you know, through experience in past lives, as well as just sort of continued conversations with peers, what, and maybe Adam can sort of speak to this better as well, is that, you know, the cannibalization is the immediate concern, right? That, you know, you're going to sort of eat into your full price business. But ultimately, from the third parties that I've spoken with about re-commerce and resale, it actually ends up being sort of two different customer sets. And I think we've shared a little bit about that already. And again, this is not from the Tapestry experience perspective, but just from sort of other conversations that I've had with folks, is that, you know, the folks who are coming in and buying sort of used or previously used product ultimately is a different customer set than who's coming in and buying sort of new and full price. But exactly what was shared earlier, this becomes an opportunity for customer acquisition. It gets people, it allows people into the brand that maybe can't necessarily afford it at full price, but still want to sort of, they resonate the brand, they like the brand, they wanna, they sort of have that emotional connection to it. And so it allows for a wider audience of customers to sort of come into the into the brand. And so those are definitely the things that, our teams are constantly evaluating and looking at and just trying to figure out what makes sense.
Yeah. Danielle, do you have thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, this is something where we're actively in conversation trying to figure out what this would look like.
Mm-hmm.
And looking at the way other companies have done it. One of the companies that we were looking at is, I just had a conversation with them the other day, is Eileen Fisher.
Mm-hmm.
They're doing a hybrid where they partner with a company like Trove to run their re-commerce. But then they also have their little factory in New York that's their repair shop. So
right.
They're doing a hybrid of the two. And this feels like a really exciting time because, we're getting to look at all of these different models and what works, but it's moving so fast, right? Like I knew Adam, and then the next thing I knew, Adam had launched Recurate. So there's things that are coming on the market that essentially are refining and becoming better and better solutions along the way. So it's an exciting time to be looking around, but it also really helps to stay abreast of what's new and what's happening, and then really be able to evaluate what works for your company, right? What works for us may not be what works for Tapestry. It still gets at the concept of circularity, but we have to figure out who our customer is and what's going to work for them. Best example, one of the challenges for us is we don't have retail stores, right? Right. We sell through our partnerships, we wholesale to large global retailers. Do we do a take back with them? How do we manage that? So I think our model is just going to look different from others, but still get at circularity in the end.
Right, right. Yeah, well, so you mentioned Eileen Fisher, and they have upcycling as well. Is that something that either of you have looked at?
Yeah, our designers are excited about that, right? We've seen pictures of that, like, a two old jackets sewn together, right? It's from a pair of jeans becoming something else.
Right.
I'm really thinking about, probably more capsule collections right now, which, I think that's what most people, if they do it at all, they're doing them in the capsule collection. But our designers are very excited of looking at those kind of models and thinking around that and coming up with ideas for it. We have a really big celebration plan next year for Wrangler's 75th anniversary.
Oh, wow.
So we're hoping to have some really unique things come to market. I can't make any promises right now, but certainly something like capsule collection made with older pieces is one of the things that we're looking at.
And I tell me if I'm wrong. I've always thought that abroad, Wrangler and Lee were premium products, right? Whereas in the United States, they're basic staples. You can get them at Walmart. But when you go to Paris and Russia, they're sold at a premium.
Yeah, I think in the U.S., they, because of their heritage, they started as workwear.
Mm-hmm.
And, when it's gone abroad, it's more seen as a premium denim brand. So certainly the price point and the customer is somewhat different.
Right.
But they're still buying into the durability and the heritage and the look of Wrangler and Lee brands.
Right. So, Logan, you're responsible for all of sustainability at Tapestry. So how does circularity fit into the broader piece of sustainability?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely a core piece of it. I mean, I think we are still, we're still figuring that out. I mean, like I said earlier, we at Coach, it's very apparent because we have the repair center for Coach brand. We're really, taking that approach that we talked about earlier, which is the definition of circularity, looking at safe and renewable materials, products that are made to be made again, or sort of what is that opportunity for recycling, and then those new business models to extend the life of products. And so, really right now, we're probably deeper entrenched in that first piece of how do you define environmentally preferred materials? How do you articulate what those are, how do you increase adoption of them, and sort of sharing those learnings with designers and material teams and product teams to make sure that we are on the front end, doing the best we can at reducing the environmental impact of the product. And then ultimately just trying to look at what are the new ways of designing, as sort of we've shared a little bit before, but, on what does that end of life look like? How do we just create products that are going to last? How do we, increase care and repair? How do we increase that emotional durability with products? And I think that's something that is relevant across all three of our brands. It's not something that's more specific to one or the other. And then obviously always looking at what those new opportunities are for new business models. And, definitely there's been a lot of sort of focus at Coach Brand on Coach Originals and vintage. Mm-hmm. And even on the most recent shows, similar to what Danielle was sharing, a couple small capsules on upcycling. And the question is always, how do you increase that at scale? I mean, I think there's been plenty written across the media around fashion and apparel and the amount of waste within the system. Mm-hmm. And so there's plenty of material out there for sort of creating products new or also taking back old products and turning them into something else. So I think, that's definitely something that we're always looking at. We don't have any great solutions at the moment, but really just trying to focus on those opportunities on where we see the most impact across the value chain.
Are you finding that like your investors, your consumers, and your employees are demanding more sustainability from you?
I think across the board, I think all of our stakeholders are asking for us to do more and to do more faster. And so, that's always the challenge is you could spend all of your time trying to tell the story of what you're doing, or you could spend a lot of your time trying to do the stuff that you're trying to do.
Right.
And it's always a bit of a challenge to find the balance between the two. But absolutely, we've got, the increased excitement and enthusiasm from our employees. We've got new hires who are sharing that some of the first things that they looked at when even considering taking a job with Tapestry was where we stood on mm-hmm. environmental social governance. And then we definitely have increased focus from shareholders. Everyone has seen sort of the most recent letter from Larry Fink and BlackRock, really just prioritizing disclosure, communication, and really focusing on how brands and companies can reduce their impact on the environment.
Adam, do you think that like it's a trade-off between being sustainable and being profitable? It's like, is it going to cost more money to do these things that the consumer wants, the investor wants, the employees want?
I hope not. I mean, regardless, this needs to be done, and we can only go so much longer being unsustainable. So it is a boundary that's out of our control. But I will say that I think the brands that are the most creative and innovative are the ones that are going to be able to do both successfully. Again, I'm probably a broken record here in the resale space, but resale is a perfect example. Doesn't require virgin resources, whether that's material or energy, and really only it requires some basic resources to transport product between customers. I think that's probably just one, but I'm sure there are other business models or interesting, unique opportunities out there where companies can continue to grow their bottom line, continue to be successful with their customers, continue to create amazing products and delight their customers without as significant an environmental impact. So again, I think the most creative are the ones that are going to be able to do this.
Danielle, do you think your American customer that is would be willing to pay another dollar or two for a product that was organic cotton and more sustainable?
Yeah, it's interesting. I actually just did an internal, we have an internal sustainability academy where uh-huh. people, within Contour Brands can participate. And I had 207 people tune in from around the globe that were interested in learning about circularity, right? I chuckled mm-hmm. when you asked Logan about internal interest, I'll get emails from like the summer intern that says, do you know about what this company is doing? Have you heard of this technology?
Right.
And sometimes it's, you know, can be a little bit to manage, but I want to harness that energy, right? I don't want to quell it at all. I'm excited that people inside the company are excited. And what we've seen is the same from the customer, right? I quoted a statistic that there's been an increase in customers that have openly said they're willing to actually change brands toward more sustainable companies because it aligns with their ethics. And so what the actual, you know, is it, you know, to name the actual dollar amount, you know, I wasn't hazard to do that. But the point is that these customers are interested in shopping their values. And, you know, there's been a lot of media around people kind of re-emerging, right? Now you're thinking about your wardrobe again. You're actually starting to wear clothes again outside. And people are now being thoughtful as to, you know, how much clothing they need, right? And are these quality pieces? You know, they realized how much stuff they had. And so there's a real opportunity now as customers are kind of re-entering and re-entering life, but also re-entering these textile and clothing and accessory markets, that they're going to be more thoughtful and intentional about what they buy. And so you want to align with that customer's values.
Well, on that note, I think we are running out of time. I think we really hit the points I wanted to touch on. Does anyone have a final thought?
I thought Danielle summed it up really well.
Yeah, Danielle, I really do.
Yeah, that was perfect.
Yeah, it's like buy less, buy better.